Hey folks, so I'm going to start working on the centerpiece for the super diorama, the Mörser Carl. This one, Thor, is the one that I'm going to be doing, as it appeared at the Battle of Sevastopol. So dark gray with some dark yellow noodly camouflage on it. Now this kit I built, it was almost 2 years ago, a year and 8 months ago is when I built it. And it's been sitting on my shelf, moving around here and there, going on the diorama, off the diorama, as I was doing mock-ups and stuff like that over the last bunch of months. And, you know, you'd expect that maybe I'd lose some pieces and stuff like that. But essentially, I don't usually lose pieces on models and stuff, even if it's been a while since I've been working on them, because I'm generally kind of organized. And I make sure that I don't pile stuff on top of models. I keep them in very specific places. Like when I'm working on stuff, it's on my bench, and I don't put anything else on my bench while I'm working on it. And if I have to move it off my bench to work on something else, it gets put into like its box, and then that box gets put on the display shelf. That is like a kind of like a transition shelf. It's like a shelf that's always, stuff is always moving in and moving out. Like an inbox, I guess. A modeling inbox, I guess. It's actually right behind me. I don't lose parts. But sometimes, like when I go to pick something up, I'll bump something and break something. Especially on something like this, all these, there's a lot of really tiny little parts that will break really easily. On this, the only thing that really broke, these things here, one of them popped loose along the edge here, one of the ladders, the end of the ladder broke off. I've since fixed it. Now this kit was a gift from Michael Kreuzman, who is a fella who I really don't know. I met him once. He popped into a hangout once, and he'd been in a hangout once before, but he didn't really talk much, I think. I seem to have a memory of that, but I remember he popped into, it was a long time ago now, he popped into a hangout once with me and a bunch of other fellows that were in once live on YouTube. And he was in there and we were all chatting and stuff. And he said he had this kit that he wanted to get rid of because he wasn't going to build it. And he wanted to know if any of us wanted it. And he told us what it was. It was the Carl Mörser. And I looked it up. And I didn't know that much about it. But as soon as I saw it, I got intrigued. And at the same time, I had just recently come across this image, and it kind of sort of spun the fabric of my imagination, and the two of them kind of got stuck together in my head. So I told him, well, if you don't want it, I'll take it off your hands. How much do you want for it? And of course, he refused to sell it. He wouldn't sell it. He wanted to give it away. So I offered to pay for the shipping, and I can't remember how the deal worked out. Either way, the thing showed up a little while later in a big cardboard box. It didn't have its original packaging. It was like in a bunch of baggies and stuff like that. And that was fine. I mean, you know, it was free. He was generous enough to part with it, and I was extremely happy to have it, and I still am. He has my forever thanks for this, because if it wasn't for this, the Super Diorama wouldn't even exist. And it's Michael Kreuzman's fault. That's why the Super Diorama exists in the first place. So he has my eternal thanks for that. And it was a handful to build. I'd never built anything like it, not at that level of complexity, not for its size. It was enormous, and it was quite an interesting thing to research. I really enjoyed the research. It actually stemmed a whole flow of researching other things, like because this thing comes with an entourage, and I had to research all the vehicles in this entourage as well. It was fascinating. And it developed my love of rail as well. I had a kind of fading interest in railroad all my life, because my grandfather was on the railroad. He worked on the railroads. So he always, I had a thing for it, but it was a light, gentle thing, I guess. But this built on it, and now I have a love of it. And I've always used model railroading in my scale modeling in my dioramas, because the skills absolutely are transferable. So I've always studied model railroading, and now I've even gotten into model railroading. I have a layout downstairs in the basement my son and I built, And we're very proud of it. It's still not quite finished. There's still work to be done on it. And, you know, Sam is busy with sports. He's into basketball now and everything, so he doesn't have as much time as he used to. But either way, once this is done, this project is done, Sam and I have a deal that we're going to start working on that layout again. We might even expand it, make it a little bit bigger. But that's up if Mom lets us. Anyway, so if it wasn't for Michael Kreuzman, this thing wouldn't even be here. So, again, I've already thanked him several times. I'm going to thank him one more time. Thank you, Michael, for this thing, because this thing created an entire, almost 2 years of building inspiration and creativity and learning for me. It's the greatest thing that I've ever built, and it's probably going to be the greatest thing I have or will ever build. I'm about to embark on another project that was probably, may come close to it, but I don't think so. 110 figures, it's going to be hard to pass that. This is probably going to be the greatest thing I've ever going to build. And I'm super proud of it. You know, there's all kinds of stupid things about it. I don't care. I still love it. So this thing is really special to me. So now when I'm going to paint it, it's all going to be a simple paint job. These things didn't get really complex. Some had a little bit in the way of elaborate paint jobs, but this one didn't for the Battle of Sevastopol. It was just dark gray with some thin banding of dark yellow here and there. And it shouldn't be too difficult to emulate that. The detail painting will probably be limited to, I don't know if there's actually decals for the gauges. I don't think there are. So I have to detail paint the gauges that are up here, and I have to detail paint the pioneer tools that are on the front. But other than that, that's it. There's no rubber tires. The tracks are going to be painted separately. The tracks that came with the kit weren't very good. I had to replace those. The way they sat on the vehicle once I had them on, they didn't sit in a believable way that looked like they were heavy. They kind of floated a bit, and I didn't like the way they looked. So I had to do some shopping around to find a set that looked appropriate, and I found a set. I can't remember what brand they were, but eventually I found a set. They're basically clicked together. They're not very tough, so they keep coming unclicked, but they go to get back together again pretty easily, and it shouldn't be too difficult to paint them up. But when they're on the vehicle, they look like they have believable weight, which is what I want, so that's what I'll use. Now, normally when I do vehicles that have tracks and wheels, I usually do the tracks and the wheels all together as one sub-assembly. I glue them all into one piece. But I can't do that with this because the idler assembly on this thing is very complicated, and I had to scratch build it because it was missing. There was actually one sprue that was missing when Michael sent it. He forgot to put it in the box, or it was just never there in the first place. I don't know. Doesn't matter. So I had to scratch build the idler assembly on both sides, I believe. Yeah, on both sides. A couple other parts I had to scratch build as well. But they were simple things to scratch build, so it wasn't too bad. But because of that, I'm not able to build the tracks separately. So they have to, the tracks and wheels separately, I have to keep them all together. So the whole thing, the transport system and the vehicle itself, the gun itself, will all get painted the same color, dark gray, and it all gets that same noodly camouflage as well. Now, the way it's going to be configured on the diorama, the vehicle will be detrained and moving away on its own power. It'll have a driver, and so it's moving away. The transport, the trellis system, will be... The crew will have just reassembled it, so it's back into its transport configuration, and the BR-52 is getting ready to move on out for whatever reason, I don't know, to go get pizza or something. They're German, so maybe sausages and sauerkraut. Oh, that was mean. I shouldn't have said that. I feel shame. Lots of shame. Not really. I know, stereotypes are awful. So all of this is going to get one solid coat of the dark gray. Now I'm hoping I'm able to fix the dark gray issue. One thing I noticed, and I mentioned this a couple of times in comments on my other video on the BR-52. One thing I wasn't happy about the BR-52 was the, after I put the flat coat on over the Vallejo dark gray, it really brought out the blue that's in Vallejo's dark gray. So it came close to looking a lot like the Tamiya Bias dark gray. And I wasn't happy with it. It wasn't until I took it and put it over on the diorama and I didn't have the intense lights of my bench on it. Like, I have a lot of lighting here because I'm blind as a bat and I need really good lights in order to do any work. But because of the intense lighting, it was really bringing out that Panzer Bias, or Tamiya Bias dark blue on the BR-52. But when I put it on the diorama and it doesn't have those intense lights on, it's just the ambient light in the room, it looked very different. It was very dark and was very, very close to the color I was hoping for. And so did the other vehicles that were also in dark gray, which tells me that maybe my bias here on the bench isn't as off as I thought. So that it was actually more accurate than I thought it was, because in its natural light, it looks fine. So I'm probably going to go the same route with the Vallejo dark gray that I went before, using the same matte coat that I used before. I won't be doing that fade color, like lightening the dark gray with a little tiny bit of a lighter gray and then going over the top surfaces. I probably won't do that on this. Not because I want to avoid that same effect, but because I want to emulate the age of this vehicle. This vehicle was had very low usage. I mean, the only thing it did was it either sat in its depot, or it was being transported, or sat in its firing position. It didn't really do much else. It's not like it trolled around the countryside looking for sunflowers or tomatoes to pick or anything like that. It didn't go hunting, you know, Russians in the fields and stuff. It didn't do any of that. It sat in one position, fired its gun, was being transported, or was parked. It didn't do anything else. So being exposed to, like, damage and stuff like that wasn't a big thing. I know these got shelled. A couple of them received damage for being shelled. From artillery, because these things didn't have the range to escape being in range of artillery. But at Sevastopol, I know Thor didn't have any. I've seen the pictures of it. It didn't have any battle damage at all. It was in pristine condition, other than dirt from driving to its firing position. That was it. So I don't need to concentrate anything on both that. And it wasn't a very old vehicle, so fading of paint and stuff like that, like in the North African sun, wasn't really something I needed to work about or worry about. Unlike the BR-52, which had been in service for, like, since the beginning of the war and had been exposed to the sun since it first got its camouflage on, so it would have a bit of a lighter color. Not a lot, just a little bit. Same thing with the Farragostals. The Farragostals would also look very similar to this in their appearance, because they would have been the same age, roughly, maybe a little younger. So that's what I'm going to do with this. That's my plan. Now, originally, when I built this, I had actually built this gun, so it was all attached, all one piece. This was glued here, which is why this looks a little bit rough. It was because I actually removed it. And I wasn't going to paint any of that in there, because I didn't think there was going to be a need, because I'm not a big fan of wasting paint, because paint is expensive, it's an expirable product, so it's why would I waste it? You know, it's not like this thing's ever going to end up on a show and some dickhead with a pen light is going to be in there. I mean, if I ever saw anyone going at one of my models with a pen light, I'd take them apart like an old toaster. But this is probably I don't go to shows, but get me into trouble. I mean, the way I would judge a model is in its the setting that it was put down the table with. If I start going at it with a pen light, I'm it's like looking for trouble. I mean, it's a ridiculous thing to do. If you're looking at models with a pen light, you're looking at things you would never, you're looking for things you would never see normally in the model in its normal setting. Like on a shelf or on a table or even at a model show. You would never see those things in the normal setting. If you start going at it with a pen light, Well, you're looking for things that you would never ever see. It would make, and you're finding things that you should never be scoring people on. It's ridiculous to do that. And any judge that uses a pen light to look at models and stuff needs to have better eyes. They shouldn't be judging anymore because they're not qualified. That's just the way I look at it. So, and it's also probably one of the reasons I don't go to shows. The other reason is there are no shows here. The only show that was here went before the pandemic, so there's nowhere for me to go. Wouldn't matter because I don't go to them anymore anyway. So anyway, I decided to open this thing up because I was looking at it closer and I noticed all the lovely rivet detail on the side of that, and I also noticed how visible it was, and thought, well, maybe I will debond the glue and see what I can do about painting that anyway. And so I did. So I ran some Tamiya Extra Thin in there and I unglued it. So it was actually a bit of doing because it was glued in there pretty good. I was worried that I glued this and this to the inside down there, but I didn't, thankfully. Now there's no real detail in there. Not much to see. Once you put the main gun in there, you can barely see any of that. So, you know, it'll get primed, it'll get Dunkelgelb, or Dunkelgrau, dark gray, sprayed in there, and then, you know, a wash and all that stuff and everything. But I'm not going to go super crazy with the weathering other than maybe some dirt. So, you know, like soot and grime and collected dirt, because it's not like they go in there with a pressure washer and clean it out all the time. So, yeah, that's what my plan is for that. It'll probably make it easier to paint as well. I have a feeling that if I left it all together like this, it'd end up using more paint because I'm trying to paint inside these nooks and crannies and run the risk of getting like paint flooding because of all the nooks and crannies. And if I open it up like this, it's just easier to paint, and I'll end up using less paint and get better coverage in the end. And it just makes it easier to make sure I got all this detail covered in the end. So, yeah, and I left the, can't really see them because they're way over here. These top parts here, they come off from the platform, so they're separate as well. Makes it easier for me to paint them as well. So hopefully I won't break anything while I'm painting them. I plan to take as much care as I can. It will take me a little bit longer to paint this than I did the BR-52 because it's a bigger piece and there's a lot more bits and pieces that can get broken on this. And I'm going to try and remember not to use mineral spirits because there are lots of parts on here that were CA glued, and not going to run the risk of the CA glue getting melted by the mineral spirits again. The mineral spirits that I use tends to fuck up the CA glue somehow for some reason. I don't know why it does. It just does. So I'm just going to switch back to the terpenoid. I think that's it. So, that's all I'm going to do for this video. I know you might have maybe been hoping to see it actually get paint on it and everything, but I've already been talking for 20 minutes, but I really wanted to talk about Michael and thank him and all that stuff and everything. I knew it was going to take me a few minutes to do. So I wanted to get that out of the way because it was really important. And I figured 20 minutes is going to be enough for the first of the main piece. So the next video is going to be priming, painting, and weathering and all that stuff. I'm going to try and clip it all together into one video so it's not three separate videos like it was the BR-52. I'll try and condense it into one video. No promises. Anyway, that's all I got. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.